You all may be seated. There's a great spirit of worship here tonight. I'm thankful for that. I know Brother Larry alluded to it, but how many of you have been enjoying this series, Draw Near, the book of James? Hasn't it been great? I was not even here in the sanctuary. I was on the premises last Wednesday night, Hyphen, which is our college and career group. They are going through kind of like a financial series. And so my husband and I were in there last week, and I wanted to hear Brother Denton, so I made sure to pull it up on YouTube and to be able to listen to that message. And I enjoyed it very much. And that, of course, is going to be where I'm going to follow after that as well, because we're still in the book of James, chapter 3. But how many of you have gone to our YouTube channel? Did you know that we've got one? It's New Life Church Cabot. And if you'll go to the YouTube, you can pull up the series for Draw Near. So if you haven't been here for one of those, go back and listen to it. That way you will get the whole book of James and it'll all come together. So I encourage that. We're going to continue, as I mentioned, in chapter 3. So you can get your Bibles nearby. And the very first part of that chapter, verses 1 through 12, if you were here last week and know that it had talked about the tongue and the power of the tongue and controlling our tongue and what we say really matters. And we're going to go straight in from that, and we're going to talk about wisdom. I'm going to finish up the last few verses. Now, everyone got a lot of verses. I think Brother Nate had like almost the whole first chapter of James, and he ran through. I have like 6 verses. So at first I thought you guys are going to get out really early. We're all going to be at Sonic because I've got 6 verses. But let me tell you what, there's so much to the Word of God. And once you get digging it out and studying all that, then my 6 verses feel like they're about 30 verses. So don't get nervous. I'm going to get you out on time. But it was an exciting study. It is something I appreciate when you are studying the Word of God and you're preparing, even if you're a Sunday school teacher. And you're getting out the Word of God and you're looking at that, and it may be verses that you're familiar with, and at the same time, God is speaking to you and God is showing you things. So that's kind of just a privilege of being able to be a teacher and to share, is that God is doing these and the person who's presenting that. So I had a blast just going through the book of James. So we're going to get started, and we're going to, as I mentioned, we're going to talk about wisdom. Now, when I think of wisdom, just kind of one of the first things that came in my head were wisdom teeth. Wisdom teeth. How many of you have had your wisdom teeth removed before? Okay. How many of you had someone video you afterwards? After you came out of that sedation, have you seen those crazy videos? That is pure entertainment. If you have nothing to do and you need to laugh, just go to YouTube, pull it up on the internet, and look at people who have had their wisdom teeth removed. And as they've come out of their sedation, they are talking crazy out of their head. My daughter had her wisdom teeth removed about 2 years ago, and I had my phone ready because I heard it's going to be good. And let me tell you, I was not disappointed. Because that white gauze in her mouth became bunnies. She thought she had little bunnies in her mouth. And she was so upset about these. And I mean, it was just hilarious. And of course, we've got it on video. But wisdom teeth. So we're going to deal with something a little bit deeper than wisdom teeth. But that was the first thing that came to my mind. And what's so crazy about wisdom teeth is how it was even given the name is because it's something that we develop later in life. We get it's the third molar. In case you didn't know which one of them they were. And we get them between the ages of 17 and 25. So I guess that's when they think that you're wise, between 17 and 25. And researchers have even said that your brain actually doesn't even get fully developed until you're about 25 years old. It's not even really truly mature. And some of you, I think, even disagree with that. I think you think, no, it's 45. No, you don't know my husband. It's older than 25. So we're talking about wisdom. We're going to dive right in. James chapter 3, we're going to start at verse number 13. And we can read together. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And then the last verse of this chapter, now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. So we're setting the theme for the verses that we've just read about wisdom. So if we're going to talk about wisdom, let's first define what wisdom is. According to Webster's Dictionary, it defines it as the right use or exercise of knowledge. That's Webster's Dictionary. So this would differentiate wisdom from just knowledge. Because in knowledge, you can know a lot. You can be smart. You can know a lot of things. But if you don't know how to apply those things in your life, or let's even just use about the Word of God, you may know a lot about the Word of God, but if you don't apply it to your life, it doesn't automatically make you wise. You just have a lot of information. The word wisdom is a translation of several Hebrew words in the Old Testament. The most common is chokmah. And this word is talking about a skill of which to perform duties. So people who would have chokmah, it would mean they have a skill to produce or to be able to perform the things that they need to do. For instance, in the Bible, it refers this word to craftsmen, singers, administrators, and counselors. These are just a few examples of ones that have this type of wisdom. But having God's wisdom is defined as properly applying his word. And if you could go ahead and put that definition, God's wisdom is properly applying his word to everyday life. And that makes it pretty simple, doesn't it, when you think of it? This is what wisdom means in God's definition. Properly applying his word to, or we could say, our everyday life. Or in other words, being skilled in godly living. Really, this is wisdom. This is what it is. This wisdom is revealed through God's word. We don't get wise just because we're old. We don't get wisdom just because we've been in the church a long time or that we've been a Christian for a long time. We receive godly wisdom by understanding his word and applying his word to our lives. It's easy to claim wisdom, but wisdom is seen through your life, according to James. That's what he's talking about in verse 13. It's seen through your life. He's saying, don't just claim that you're wise or you have wisdom. Show us. Let us see it. So James begins this passage with a question. Who is wise and understanding among you? Now, the book of James was an epistle or letters that were written to the church. So he was not there speaking to a live audience. They were letters. Perhaps they were read to the group of people, the church. So let's say that someone is up there reading James' epistle to the church. And he's saying, who is wise and understanding among you? And can you just see some of the ones that are there kind of just puffing out their chest a little bit? Or maybe they're pointing to the guy next to him. Yeah, he's considered that. Or this person thinking, oh, this teacher is definitely wise and has much understanding. So James is sort of setting them up. He's asking the question. And then as soon as maybe people start thinking about who that might be, is that me? Is this person next to me? Then he hits them with this and he says, let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. In other words, let how you live your life prove you have wisdom. If you say you have wisdom and understanding, as he asked the question, then let's see it. Now, if you're reading from the King James Version, it will say good conversation instead of good conduct. This doesn't mean, however, anything verbal. We've already talked 12 verses about the tongue and our words. So we're moving beyond that. It is translated as behavior or conduct. And the New King James Version is what we're using. It actually has just already translated for us. So if you see the word conversation, you can automatically insert conduct and know that's what it's talking about. Works in this verse are the things that you do, a deed. And after that, it gets even more specific. So it's talking about good works. But then, really, your good works are not enough. There's more to that. It's our attitude that counts. You see, in the New Testament, we actually live a higher, we live a high, according to a higher law than in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, they had hundreds of laws to follow, but they could scratch it off at the end of the day and said, yep, I did that one, I did that, I did that. But in the New Testament, it's not just what you do. It's not just your good deeds, but it says more. It's about your attitude. Those good deeds must be with meek wisdom. And so in this scripture, when we think about our attitudes, we can think about how this is a precedent that is set throughout the New Testament. When God says he loves a cheerful giver, it's not just the good act of giving to someone or to the church or pay your tithes or whatever it is. He wants a what kind of giver? He wants a cheerful giver, which shows our attitude about that. It's not just about the money. It's our attitude. In Matthew, we're admonished that when we fast, which is a works, which is something good, we're not to just do it so people could see us and applaud us for, you know, their sacrifice that we've done. Fasting is our deed, but humbleness should be our attitude. They were actually admonished to not let your alms be seen before men, and talking about how it should be private and secret. It's between you and God, because it wasn't just the fasting act, but it was also how you conducted yourself, your attitude about that. So if we are to do our deeds in meekness of wisdom, then we need to know, what does that mean? Meekness simply means a mild disposition, a mild disposition. The Greeks described it, and I love this, they described it as power under control. Power under control, or humility. It's like a tamed horse that is very powerful, but it's in submission to its master. We have the power to do a lot of things, but we instead practice self-control and submission to God's principles in our lives. Meekness isn't someone who is sissy or weak-minded or soft-spoken or whatever would come to your mind about someone who's meek. It has nothing to do with our personalities. Moses was considered the meekest man in the earth, and yet he was a very strong leader. You didn't see Moses backing up, and he went to Pharaoh, and he was a very strong leader. But it said he was the meekest man on earth. So it has nothing to do with your personality. It is a choice. It is a choice of bringing our power under control. So James is telling us that the good things we do must be done with an attitude of meekness as we live applying God's word to our lives. That's what we're admonished. Let's go to the next verse, number 14. We're contrasting the previous verse, which is the correct attitude of being meek. And now we're reading, but if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. So now we're not just dealing with our attitudes, but now our motives are being examined as well. Our motives. Commentaries state that this was not just a hypothetical situation that James was talking about. The if didn't mean like, you know, maybe if that applies, or, you know, if this would ever happen. They were already dealing with this in the church. This was already going on, and he was addressing this situation. The Greek term for bitter is sharp, through the idea of piercing, something so sharp and piercing. So when you put bitterness and combine it with the word envy, the bitter envy, it defines it as a piercing of harsh, resentful attitude towards others. A harsh, resentful attitude towards others. This is a very poisonous attitude. How often have we seen someone go through great disappointments in life, and they have allowed bitterness to creep into their spirit, into their heart, and now they can no longer rejoice in the good of what's taking place in other people's lives, because all they can see is what they don't have. And that envying comes up, and not just an envy, but a bitter envy. Their lives can become eaten up with this envy. People with bitter envy are not joyful people. Their happiness may only be temporary because they truly can't experience the happiness that the Lord has for them because that only comes through selfless love. And they are self-seeking for themselves, the bitter envy. Next, self-seeking goes hand in hand with bitter envy. Self-seeking is based on selfish motives and desires. So we have self-seeking and bitter envy, and these are the things that we are not to be partakers of. Sometimes we look at that and think, well, I don't think that applies to me. I don't think I have bitter envy. I'm not a self-seeking person. I try to give to people, and I try to think of other people. But I want us to examine that because this is where the Lord takes me through, is that, number one, sometimes the self-seeking part of it can be missed in our own lives because, number one, it's a heart issue. Remember, we're talking about these are the things in your heart. It's a hidden motive in our heart, but it can be surrounded by good acts or deeds. And then when you focus on, but this is something good, and I've done this, and the Lord says, okay, that's wonderful. Let's peel back some layers and let's check our motives. Let's just check our motives and make sure everything lines up with the Word of God. So sometimes self-seeking is simply doing things because we have a need for affirmation. Some of the things that we might do are driven by a self-seeking motive of, if I do this, I'll be affirmed. People will really say that that's awesome. It'll make me feel good, and it's a need for affirmation. Or maybe I'll do this because it makes me look smart or important, or maybe it's because I have a need to be valued, and I need to think that I'm really making a difference in the world. And so don't read more. I mean, I don't think we need to walk around and think everything we do is bad, and man, I gave in the offering. I probably did it just because I was wanting people to see me walk up there. I don't think we need to walk around living this way, but it is something to be cognizant of because we don't want to be guilty of a self-seeking motive. Because remember, our attitudes, our motives make a difference. They are being looked at. We will be judged for those things. So James is saying, if these things, bitter envy, self-seeking is in your heart, don't boast about it. Don't boast about yourself or what you've done, making yourself to look bigger in the eyes of people. And don't lie against the truth. These are the things that he is saying you must not do. Verse number 15. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. So now we recognize, there's two different kinds of wisdoms. So we talked about the wisdom that we're supposed to show with meekness in wisdom. But now we see that there is another kind. It doesn't come from above. It is not from the Lord, but it's earthly, sensual, demonic. It's self-seeking wisdom. It's not meek like James is admonishing for us to have. It has the same attributes as godly wisdom. It too means skilled and knowledgeable, but it's for worldly or selfish pleasures. It's not from God. And worldly wisdom, and I think actually Brother Denton alluded to it last week, worldly wisdom seeks to have power or position. This wisdom is earthly, and that simply means it's limited to just earthly things. It literally means that, or even temporal. It's not going to last. It'll pass away. Sensual just means it's not spiritual. And demonic, I think that says it very clearly. James was pretty bold in all of that. Do you think he was clear enough? Let me just tell you, this wisdom, having this envy in your heart, self-seeking, whether they're impure motives or whatever it is going on in your life, this is not what you want to have. And so James, I think, added that just in case that they thought it was okay to play around with envy and self-seeking, he's letting them know this kind of wisdom is of the devil. I think that should get our attention because I know I don't want anything of my life associated with demonic present spirits or anything like that. Anything we open ourselves up to, we allow the enemy to gain access into our lives. I don't want him coming in and trying to plant strongholds. We've got to flee anything that is of Satan. So James doesn't mask any words. And he doesn't even try to be politically correct in that verse. And so, by the way, if you have read through James chapter 1 and James chapter 2, I notice something. I noticed his tone was just a little bit softer than it was in chapter 3. I noticed things like verse number 16. He'd say, "Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren." Verse 19, he'd say, "So then, my beloved brethren." And then even in chapter 2, he's saying, "Now listen, my beloved brethren." But by the time you get to chapter 3, he's dropped the beloved. It's gone, and you don't even see it the rest of the chapter. It's like he's kind of softening him up. He's coming in, and here's the things you need to know about. And then chapter 3 comes, and he's getting a little more quick and to the point, and no more beloved brethren at all. He actually drops the beloved, and he calls them brethren. So now can't you just hear him, you know, the beloved brethren, kind of hear that in a nice tone, and then he's saying, "All right, brethren, let me just tell you, I'm going to be more direct and to the point." And then by the end of chapter 5, I don't even think he mentions anything. His salutation, because the first three chapters begins with brethren, by chapter 4 and 5, he just gets right to the point. It's so funny when you look at that, because we have to look at the Word of God as it was written and the author and what it was intended, knowing these were letters and how he's talking to the church. And when you put all of that together, you sort of get a little greater inside knowledge and understanding about what he was trying to communicate to people. All right, let's continue. Verse number 16. "For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there." So if there's envy and self-seeking or selfishness, it says there's confusion and every evil thing there. Listen to what confusion means in the Greek. Instability. Instability. Do you see now why the enemy tries to sow confusion in our lives? It makes us unstable. Unstable in our thinking, in our decisions. Pastor Nate read about that in the very first lesson of James. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So when we don't make up our mind on things, and I'm not talking about which car to buy and, you know, anything like that, or restaurant to go to after church, but I'm talking about issues of the heart. I'm talking about salvation issues. I'm talking about things that you've heard preached and you may not understand it, and you waffle back and forth, and it goes into months and it can go into years, and the confusion is being bred. Instability. And it says that we're unstable in all your ways, being double-minded, flipping back and forth on an issue about things. We have to settle in our hearts the things that we believe about God. And we'll be tested in those things at times, but we have to settle the issue once and for all. There have been things in my life that I have settled, or I thought I did, and then 2 years later, a question would come up about it again, or something would shake my faith or my belief in it. And I had a choice to make. I could choose to open myself up to new thoughts about that, or ways, or doubt God. Maybe that's not exactly what his words. Maybe that's really not how you live it out, and open myself up to that. But at the same time, I believe you can start opening yourself up to confusion. And the enemy would love to start putting things into your mind because it makes you unstable. So we have to settle that once and for all. 1 Corinthians 14:33. "But God is not the author of confusion, but of peace." So he gives us peace. And guess what? When we settle those issues, he gives us a peace about that, because that's the author. That's what God gives to us, not confusion. Verse number 17. "But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy." So if you live by worldly wisdom, which has already been defined as envious and self-seeking, then what you get is confusion and every evil thing. Every evil thing. Think about that. That means that the enemy has like a complete smorgasbord of evil for you to partake of. Like, here's what I offer you if this is the kind of wisdom that you want to live in. But verse number 17 gives us a much better option, and a lot more of it too, I might add. "The wisdom that is from above," in other words, the wisdom that God authors, "is first of all pure." Everybody say pure. pure. It establishes right off spiritual integrity, not with ulterior motives. Godly wisdom produces purity of heart. His wisdom keeps our hearts and our motives pure. Do you want to know God in an even greater way? Then keep your heart pure. Because the Bible says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So purity is a big deal in our lives. And let me tell you, we cannot afford to let any area of our life be open to the enemy and to try to steal our purity. The series that we've been talking about is Draw Near. That's a big key of this. Draw near. You want to draw near to God? You want to know him? Then we've got to have pure hearts, pure motives. God has purity for our bodies, for our conversations, for the things that we look at, for the things that we do. He wants us to be pure in every single area. And so we have to examine ourselves because the word of God is a mirror. And it comes back to us that as we read his word, it shows us the areas that are not pure. You know what? My thought wasn't pure in that today. God, forgive me. Lord, wash my mind right now. Make me pure in you. I can't afford any area of my life to be impure because I want to know you. I want to draw near to you. And it's the very first thing about godly wisdom is this purity. And that is a big deal. Now, I have a picture that I want to show you, and it's of a book. And in case you can't read that, and for our online people, I'll read it to you. It says, Things I Refrain from Saying on the Internet, Volume 1. I wonder how many volumes there are. A lot, I'm sure. And it's probably a 300-page book. The Things I Refrain from Saying on the Internet. Now, this is for all of you who have had that thought. First of all, this is for all of you that either are on the internet and you read other people's posts or you like to post. And there have been things that you wanted to post about. Man, you woke up with that on your mind and you thought, I'm just going to go to social media and I'm going to let the world know about this. So for all of you that have refrained, here you go. This book, we need to just order several copies and have it in the foyer, and we can have that for sale because now you can just spare all the rest of us from that thought, and you can write in your book, and maybe you could show your husband or your children or whoever, or maybe you'll never show anybody else. And let me just tell you, I think it makes a wonderful gift. So if you have anybody who you think needs this book, you don't even have to say anything. Just wrap it up real pretty and give it to them, and they will get the hint about social media. So now why am I showing you this? Because I want to talk about pure motives on the internet just for a few minutes because wisdom is practical. Everybody say, wisdom is practical. The Lord knows that we are practical people. We have to go to work, go to school, we have children, we eat, we have all these things every day. His wisdom is not all just a spiritual thing that we're just in prayer all day. It's practical living for our lives every day, including our internet. So I want to just share a testimony with you, and I will just become transparent to let you know how the Lord has helped me with this. So this was a few months ago, and I was frustrated. Oh, I was expecting everybody to look shocked. I was frustrated. I was actually frustrated with someone's actions. And it was really bothering me to the point where it was causing an offense in my life. Now, lest anybody think that it is someone in this room, you all can be relieved. It is nobody in this room. I remember years ago, are you relieved, Brother Shirley? It's not you. I remember years ago, my pastor, and I went to a fairly large church, and I remember he got up in the pulpit and he said, I just have to say something. I'm just so disturbed. There is someone in the congregation and you are causing a distraction right now. You are not paying attention and you are not listening. And I just want you to know I would appreciate for you to stop. And it's really distracting and bothering me. And then he went on with this message. And the next Sunday he said he got like 10 notes from people. 10 different people that were confessing of, I am so sorry. you know, I wasn't feeling good or my husband was asking me a question, he laughed so hard because a lot of people took that. So it's nobody in this room, but I am going to just share this because I do feel like it's something that if this can help you, then praise God because it helped me. So I was bothered about this and I was mulling over it and I, you know, was troubled. What should I do? And all of a sudden I got a great idea. Okay, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go on Facebook and I'm going to post a really positive post. It's going to be really positive, but it's going to have like some really good points in there. And I'm going to make it vague, but I think that person is going to look at that and know, oh my goodness, this could apply to me. I need to do a better job. Because it was just going to be sweet and kind and have lots of good, you know, information to help people. And so I started composing it, and it was really good. I mean, I just have to say, it was a really good post. And so a lot of times I compose things, like if I'm going to, you know, do a lot of typing, say it's a long Facebook post or whatever it is, I just do it on my notes on my phone, and then I transfer it. So it wasn't even on Facebook. So I had this post, and I just thought, oh, this is so good. This is going to help a lot of people, but especially that person. When all of a sudden, I heard God's voice speak to me, and he said this. So, you're just going to bypass Matthew chapter 18, which, by the way, is God's conflict resolution passage for his people. For us to live by, about what happens when we have offense and what we should do about that. So the Lord said, okay, so you're going to bypass Matthew chapter 18, and instead of having the courage to go to that person, you're going to just be passive aggressive, and you are going to just do it your way. And I said, yep, I didn't. I wanted to. I was just, oh, because you know what it was? The Lord was exposing my motive, and my motive was not pure. Now, here's the deal. It was a good post, and people would have thought, and they would have liked it and commented and probably shared, but I would have displeased the Lord because it was not with a pure motive of helping other people's. It was really, truly to get a message to somebody. It was something I was not dealing with myself. I was not using the word of God properly. And I was bypassing all of that to do it my own way. So that was my testimony to say that that was an eye-opener for me. And I know that's talking about social media because that is a big deal for people. And a lot of times that does seem to be an outlet where people who would never go to someone and make something right would rather post on Facebook. Do y'all love me? I'm your pastor's wife. I love you. I'm telling you, I'm here. I'm not immune to that. But we either are going to live by wisdom and live by the word of God, applying it to our lives, our everyday lives, or we're going to do it the worldly way, and we're going to do it in a self-seeking way or an envious way that benefits us. And I sure don't want to be open to the things of the enemy because of that. It is a big deal. So after purity, the next one is peaceable. God's wisdom helps us to live in peace with each other and that we ourselves will have peace. There are so many verses about peace in the Bible. If you will just do a word search of peace, it will tell you we are to seek for peace, that our minds will have peace if we'll stay on the word. If we will stay on the word of God, we'll have that. That his peace is a gift. That we should live peaceably with people. All kinds of things. God's wisdom promotes peace. We aren't to live antagonistic with others. Because when we do, we're automatically showing that we're not living in God's wisdom. Because number two is peaceable. And remember, these were the issues that people were facing in the church that James was dealing with. Okay, these were good Christian people, but they were dealing with these same kind of issues. The next thing is gentle. Another thing that God's wisdom gives us is gentleness, which just means mild or patient. This is what his wisdom is about. Another one, and it's a big one, is willing to yield. willing to yield. So God's wisdom in my life helps me to be willing to yield, that it's not just about my agenda or always being right or pushing my way, that I can say, you know what, that's fine. I may not totally agree with it, but this happens in marriages, right? Willing to yield. What happens when two people are going down the same street and then a two lane goes to a one lane? What happens if you don't yield? One person doesn't yield to the other. You're going to sideswipe. You're going to have a car wreck. And so a yielding is letting someone else have their way, and then you can just follow in behind them, willing to yield. The next one is full of mercy and good fruits. Full of mercy and good fruits. It's easy to show mercy when we never forget how much mercy we've been shown. This is something I have to, because a lot of times we can get upset and, oh, this person, and you can get disappointed, and this is the 15th time they've done this, and oh, all these things that we go through. And then I just stop and think, but Lord, you show me mercy at all the things that I mess up on, and I keep failing and keep making a mistake. So when we show mercy, we're showing his wisdom. Let's just praise God right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your word. God, that when we live by your word, Jesus, that you have promises for us. God, that we would live peaceably, that we would show mercy in the name of Jesus. Empower us, God. Help us, Lord, making good choices to honor you, that our lives would bring you glory in the name of Jesus. A natural byproduct of wisdom is good fruit. This is something that he gives, mercy and good fruits. Here's what God's wisdom does not have. Partiality. That means it doesn't show favoritism. It's not impartial. Or I'm sorry, it is impartial. Shows no favoritism or is impartial. Treats everybody the same. Doesn't discriminate. No prejudice. Partiality. The other thing and the last is, and without hypocrisy. In other words, it's sincere in what it does. It doesn't live two different ways. God's wisdom is not just for when we're at church, but then we kind of do a different thing when we're home, we're at workplace. God's wisdom helps us to live consistent wherever we are without hypocrisy, that we are sincere in what we're doing and that people know, whether they see us in Branson or downtown Cabot or in the church, that we are the same. And that is a huge part and the ending part of wisdom. Now, there's a lot more good things that you get when you live applying God's word to your life than living worldly wisdom. And then we're going to finish up by this verse. Verse 18. Now, the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. So James finishes up this chapter and goes right back to peace again. Because, you know, really this whole chapter is talking about relationships and how we handle things with people. And so he's ending it with peace. And he's saying, if you want the fruit of righteousness in your life, then you have to sow peace. And that we are to seek peace. It's important to realize that James has really helped us to avoid those pitfalls in relationships and those conflicts if we will live this way. If we will live not being selfish, but we will live with God's wisdom. And that we cannot do it without peace. To have peace in our relationship, we have to have God's wisdom. James tells us in chapter 1 that if you lack wisdom, because we're talking about wisdom, we're going to finish with that. If you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given him. It will be given. And Pastor Nate did such a great job driving that point home in the very first lesson. And so we're to ask for it. Proverbs 4:7, wisdom is the principal thing. It's the first thing. It's the most important. It's the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. Turn to your neighbor and say, get wisdom. Turn to the other person and say, you too. And then point to yourself. So foolishness is the opposite of wisdom. And if you read the book of Proverbs, you will see that almost in every chapter, it will contrast foolishness and wisdom. And if we do this, we're foolish. But if we do this, we're wise. Back and forth. So really, foolishness is just the opposite of wisdom. Foolishness is to be godless or at the very least, not inviting God's word and his presence into our situation. That's what foolishness is. And if you have ever read the book of Proverbs, you will know that we are chastised if we are foolish, and that we are considered immature if we are foolish. So that's not what we want to do. We want to live by God's wisdom. So how do we get wisdom? We know it's the principal thing. James has driven this point home. He's compared it from the worldly wisdom and God's wisdom. How do we get wisdom? So James 1, we already know we are to ask for it. We are to ask for it. But this is just the beginning. Because guess what? God doesn't just take something and deposit it into our head and bam, you're a wise person. Bam, you've got wisdom. Just say, Lord, make me wise. Give me wisdom. And the Lord goes, woo-hoo. And then all of a sudden, you're wise. It doesn't work that way. That is the first thing we do, is ask for it. But wisdom, remember, is properly applying God's word to our everyday life. So we have to know what God's word said if we're going to apply it to our lives. We have to understand his word in order to apply it to our lives. So we ask him, but then it's up to us to read and to listen to the word of God. And then we ask, God, give me wisdom. As I'm reading your word, give me understanding. Help me to see what this means of what you've intended. I don't want to have the Stacy version in my own application and interpretation. Show me what this means, Lord. Give me an understanding of your word. And then the asking part is, God, help me to know how to apply your word to my life. That's what asking for wisdom is. It's not just to name it and blab it and grab it in your prayer. We have to have the part of reading the word of God for ourselves and asking for understanding. And then the hard work of applying it. So we can know his word, we can understand his word, and then we get to a situation like mine, maybe offense, conflict, and I have a choice to make. Am I going to just do what feels right? Am I going to go by what I think would be good? Or am I going to apply the word of God? This is how we become wise. This is how we gain wisdom. It's a spiritual discipline, and it's something that we have a choice every single day. God's word is for every part of our lives. Can we all amen to that? Every area. We've already established that God, he doesn't just help us in the spirit realm in wisdom, but in the practical aspects of life. Hyphen right now are learning about finances. Oh, that sounds so unspiritual. They're at church. They should be praying and oh my goodness, they should just be learning about revelation. But the last time I checked, finances are all throughout the word of God. And the Lord talks a lot about money. So I want to know how does this apply to my life? And so as we're teaching these the specialized classes, this series and all of that are so that we can become closer, draw closer to him, and so that we can become wise people. Because as James said, we can't just declare it. We've got to show that. And it's not just, oh, they sound so wise, but then we can do really foolish things. It's both. We can talk with understanding, but our lives will also show it. So we're going to finish up here in just a moment. I want you to be able to look at some things for yourself. So there are some keys for growing in wisdom. And I want us to be able to look up some of these verses. And I think we've done this a couple of times. So why don't we go ahead and stand and find a group nearby or people that you're comfortable with. And it's okay if you want to move across the room. If there's somebody you've been wanting to connect with, I give you permission to move around the church. That's fine. But as you're going, we're going to put some scriptures up on the overhead. I want us to look these scriptures up because every single one of them deal with how we gain wisdom or how do we grow in wisdom. And so if you even want to appoint one or two people in your group, or if you all each want to take a turn, you can use your phones, or if you have an actual Bible, I want you to look these verses up and then talk about it because, like I said, they all deal with wisdom. Say, what is this asking of us? What is this telling that we need to do about wisdom, okay? The first one is Psalm 90 and 12. Psalm 90 and 12. And then the next person, if they want to look this one up, it's Psalm 111 and 10. Psalm 111 and 10. I've got four verses for you. The third one is Proverbs 2 and verse 2. And then the last one is Proverbs 2 and 7. So we've got Psalms 90 and 12, 111 and 10 of Psalms, then Proverbs 2 and 2, and Proverbs 2 and 7, okay? So let's just take a few minutes. We're about to wind up. But read those. Somebody read that aloud to your group. And then talk about that. What is this asking of us? How we can gain.